It won't record. I push that.
Forward. The ones who didn't will be here in time for the potluck later after services, so they won't miss out on the food anyway. I'd like to remind you to sign the red book located at the end of the pew. If you're visiting with us, we extend to you a special welcome. We're happy you're here. We'd also like to ask you if you might fill out the flap that's on the front of the bulletin and place it in the offering plate as it's passed. We have this engagement challenge that started with Lent, and we're moving our way through the month. How'd you do last week? I did all right till I got to Friday and Saturday. Saturday I knew it was going to be a bomb because everything we have at work has a screen on. But Friday, I thought maybe I'd be all right, but we have these evil little things that work their way into our house. They're called jelly beans. And 2 weeks ago, we went to the store and they had them on sale. 3 bags for $8. So you got to get 3 bags, right? So I thought, you know, probably by Friday they'd be gone, but somewhere along the line, a bag of all black ones entered into the picture. So, and, you know, you can only get those at Easter time, I'm told. For the first 45 years we were married, Cindy told me that. I didn't believe her. Now I do. You can only get them at Easter time unless you're willing to spring for the jelly bellies. So I didn't do too well on that one, but the rest of them weren't too bad. This week coming up, today we're asked to pray for the families of those who have family members who have died or loved ones who have died in the past year. On Monday, pray for the sick, send someone a card or some flowers or something like that. That's not too tough to do. On the 10th, Tuesday, is pray for the homeless. On the 11th, we pray for clean water. We all want that. And the challenge is not to use any plastic disposables. On Thursday, the 12th, pray for those who are struggling with addiction. On 13, be gluten, nut, and shellfish fish free today. And pray for those who have severe allergies. And then Saturday is fast from email and text messages. For some might be easy, that's going to be a little tougher one for me, but we'll give it a shot. If you'd be aware of that, and we may not be able to do all of them, but if we can do some, it's a nice challenge and makes you feel good about yourself, and you can do something good for others too. Prayer requests, I'd like to remind you to pray for those who are in the bulletin for those needs that are listed. And also, I'd like to draw emphasis to our missionaries, Joshua, Tia, Ezra, and Marilyn Lane, who are serving us in the Dominican Republic. Anniversaries this coming week. Dean and Brenda, you got the whole week for yourself. There's no other anniversaries or birthdays, so the week's all yours. So if you might remember them, and happy anniversary to you. I don't see where they're at. They left. Oh, they started the celebration early. Announcements for today. 11:30 is covered dish dinner right after church. And at 5 o'clock is Sunday evening study. On Tuesday at 6:30, the trustees will meet. On Wednesday at 8 o'clock a.m. is adult breakfast. 3:45, Circle J. 6 o'clock's choir, and 7:20 is ladies' Bible study. On Saturday this week, our memorial service is for our friend Bob Black here at the church. And then I'd like to call your attention, now through March 22nd is the supply drive for Victory Village. So the list is on the sheet on the bulletin board back by the office, as well as the stack of supplies that have been collected. Looking ahead, on March 21st is the men's breakfast, so if you RSVP in the red book or let the office know so they'll know how much breakfast to prepare. And then on Sunday, March 29th, that'll be the fifth Sunday of this month, the Sunday school breakfast at 9:15 a.m., and the guest speaker will be Pat Pearson. And then the last thing looking forward to on Tuesday, April 21st, is the ladies' spring fling beginning at 6:15. So if you're involved or interested in that, make note of that on your calendar. I don't know that there's any other announcements that need to be made, but I think most of them are on the board as well as emphasized here. Isaiah 40:28 says, as we begin to think about our praise to God in song, says, "Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable." And that's what this first song is talking about, is the praise. It's got our redemption all lined up in one song. God, everlasting, he was here at the beginning, he's here at the end, he cares for us, he loves us, he's strong, he's faithful. We've got it all. So let's lift our hearts to him as we stand and sing as you're able. Everlasting God. strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. taken out of the book of John, chapter 8, and it's verses 12 through 20. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light. The Pharisees therefore said to him, You bear witness of yourself. Your witness is not true. Jesus answered and said to them, Even if I bear witness of myself, my witness is true, for I know where I came from and where I'm going. But you do not know where I have come from and where I'm going. You judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. And yet if I do judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am with the Father who sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one who bears witness of myself, and the Father who sent me bears witness of me. Then they said to him, Where is your Father? Jesus answered, You know neither me nor my Father. If you had known me, you would also have known my Father. These words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, and no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come. Shall we pray? Our God and Father, we come before your throne this morning. We come to worship you and love you, show our love to you and learn from your word. We ask that you be with us during this service this morning, that you might wrap your arms around us and draw us close. Reveal to us your will, embedded in our hearts and our souls. We ask that you be with each and every one here this morning. Be with our pastor as he delivers your message, that we might glean from it as you wish for us to have. We ask all those who are participating this morning that you might especially bless them, as well as those people who are present with us, whether here in this physical building or with us in heart, maybe away somewhere. We ask that you continue to guide and direct us, and we give you all the love, all the glory, all the honor, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you please be seated.
Transcend all the reasons.
Shall we pray? Our God and Father in heaven, we thank you for all those many blessings, many, many blessings that you richly bestow on us each and every day. We ask that you be with us today, that these tithes and the offerings that are taken might be given joyfully, might be given for the will of your kingdom here on earth. We ask that you bless each gift, bless each giver, for it's in Jesus' name we pray.
We listen to the world. We hear a lot of things about how we're not good enough, and you don't measure up, and those kind of things. And if we're living to please the world, we'll live in a precarious position of what have you done lately? And this will pull us away from our true relationship with God and make it hard to establish a relationship and believe that somebody can love you just with the gifts that you have. And this song is kind of a prayer of submission and recognition of who God is and who gives you the strength and the hold you up in those hard times. And that I'm not going to listen to those things out there. I'm going to identify with my Maker.
Oh, you say I
Will you pray with me? Father God, as we come together this morning, we thank you for your presence with us. We know that as we walk through the doors, each one of us brings with us our real lives. The good things, the bad things, those things that put a smile on our face, and those things that bring tears to our eyes. And Father God, we're just so very thankful that you are a God that cares about each and every one of those things. And as we unite our hearts and minds this morning in worship of you, we take this time to bring to you the cares and concerns of our congregation. For Scripture tells us we are to cast all our cares, cast all our anxiety upon you. And that is what we do, because we know that you are able to work and that you do work according to your will. Father, we lift to you the March family and the Bartley and Hemphill family, the Renier family, as they have lost loved ones recently. We think too of the Blackwood family, and we continue to lift the Jensen family as they are missing family members dearly loved. We pray that your spirit of comfort and encouragement will be poured out upon them, and we thank you for the testimony of faith in the lives of these individuals. Father, we lift to you also Randy Sutton, who's dealing with injury and dealing with other situations. And Father God, we just pray that your healing hand would be upon him. And Lord God, we know that you work miraculously, and we do pray that you would work according to your will in his life, that you would bring healing to his foot, Lord. We also pray for Bonnie Stephan and pray that you continue to strengthen and encourage her. Be with Glenn, watch over him. We pray for Martha Rundle, that you'd be with her and be with Harlan, her husband, as well. We lift you, Danny Wynn, and as he goes in this week and the following week, we ask, Lord, that your hand would be upon him, that you would use this technology according to your will. We pray for those that are traveling. We think of the Campbells and the Yarrows and others, and ask that your hand would be upon them, that you give them safety as they're away and bring them home safely. We pray for our missionaries, the Lanes, as they serve in the Dominican Republic, and ask, Lord, that your hand would be upon them, that you would provide them, provide for them and protect them. We continue to look to you, Laura Beth Cheft, and the different procedures and that she has to undergo as a result of her condition, and ask that you would continue to bless and work in that and continue to lead them as they seek to be obedient to your call to the mission field. Father, we also think of as a nation of the many people that have been infected by this virus, Lord, and we know that we are not given a spirit of fear, but a spirit of hope and a spirit of confidence. And Father, we trust in you, and we ask that you would work in this situation. We pray that even in some way you could use this situation to encourage people to make a decision to place their faith and trust in you, to accept the free gift of salvation that's only available through faith in Jesus Christ and the sacrifice that he has made on our behalf. Lord God, we just give you thanks and praise for all the ways that you work. And we know that there are many other requests and thoughts and praises that haven't been shared this morning. We give those to you as well. We lay them down before you and pray that you would work according to your will for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will you listen now as the choir sings the King Jesus Medley? Thank you.
lifted me.
Sin had me bound, but
Jesus lifted me.
Sin had me bound, but
Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm walking with the King. There is no glorious tomorrow. Now I walk with the King.
Every day I am walking with the King.
I'm walking with the King. All my steps are so much lighter since I'm walking with the King.
Every day I am walking with the King.
Comes down to join you. The children may be dismissed for Children's Church, and we thank Miss Terry for heading that up for us this morning. And as she heads out the door, we want to take just a moment, and really it deserves more than a moment, but today is the International Women's Day. Yep. And that is a day that seeks to celebrate the numerous and important contributions of women. Do you make any contributions, women? That's a joke, of course, right? We are so very thankful for the many, many ways that the many, many women in our life have blessed us, whether they are our grandmothers or mothers or our sisters, whether they are our aunts or our wives, whether they are our friends or co-workers. We are indeed blessed, and especially in this congregation, we are blessed with truly fantastic women. Right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And of course, we shouldn't have to have a special day to recognize the important contributions that women or anyone make in our lives. You know, it's always appropriate and acceptable to say thank you, to share your appreciation. You know, in our lives, there's often many, many thankless jobs. You know, people do things and they don't get that pat on the back. And of course, you know, we don't always, we don't almost, you know, almost always, we don't do things
to get a pat on the back. But it's important that we recognize. And of course, we have Mother's Day coming up, but you know, I saw that was on the calendar today. And we do recognize the importance of the ladies that are in our lives. So ladies, we do thank you. We don't say it enough. So if you have a lady in your life, and I know you do, make sure you take some time today to share your appreciation with them. Last week, we began our Lenten sermon series, and it's called I Am, and we are exploring the seven I Am statements spoken by Jesus in the Gospels of John. And I just noticed that the bulletin for today would, you know, if you save that for next week's sermon is I Am the Door. And so I was like, oh, if I'd noticed that, you know, I would have had her swap them. You know, sometimes the bulletins go along. They don't. They are pre-printed. They tell us use this one on this day, that one on that day. It's just a service that we have. And so I thought that was interesting. But last week we began by looking at Jesus' words, I am the bread of life. And in those words we were reminded of some important and some powerful truths, that Jesus is the source of our life. You know, we think about what do you need to live? You know, you go to school and they say, well, what do we need for live? Well, you need food, you need water, you need shelter, you need clothing, right? But spiritually, what do we need to live? We need Jesus. And so we were challenged and we were reminded and we celebrated the fact that Jesus is the source of our life. But not only is he the source of our life, but he is the sustainer of our life. He is the sustainer of our life as well. Today we look at John chapter 8, and I appreciate Jerry reading that for us this morning. And this chapter begins with a very familiar story. And of course, you know, you say, well, you say that all the time, Pastor. Well, yeah, especially when we go to the Gospels. These are stories that we know. We've read them in Sunday school and learned about them in Sunday school and throughout our church life. But this is a very familiar passage. It is the story of the woman caught in adultery. And the woman is taken by the scribes and the Pharisees, and they planned to honor her for International Women's Day. No, that wasn't their plan. They planned to put her to death by stoning. Yet Jesus interrupts their plan with a statement. He says, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. And in response to this, one by one, what did they do? They left. They were convicted of their own sin, and as a result, they left. In verse 11, Jesus utters a command to this woman, go, and he doesn't just end there. He says, go and sin no more. And then in verse 12, we read, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. As we remember, last week Jesus spoke of the truth that he provides us life. And today we see that it is Jesus that provides us light. Light in this dark world. Now, during the Christmas season of 2018, I know you all remember that, and I know you can specifically remember all the sermons that we had during the Christmas season of December 2018. And I'm joking, of course, but during that, the whole sermon series was about Jesus as the light of the world. So today, we're going to look at this passage from a different perspective. Jesus, in his declaration, he says, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. So, let me share with you another passage, this time from the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 8, starting at verse 16, it says, no one, when he has a little lamp, covers it with a vessel or puts it under a bed, but sets it on a lampstand that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is secret that will not be revealed, nor anything hidden that will not be known and come to light. Therefore, take heed how you hear. For whoever has, to him will be given, to him more will be given. Whoever does not have, even what he seems to have will be taken from him. One of the main ideas that is connected with Jesus Christ as our light or the light of the world is that he has brought and he brings to us knowledge, awareness, understanding. And this morning, the second Sunday of Lent, as we look forward to and as we prepare for our celebration of the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Sunday, we're going to be reminded of three truths that we have learned, three realities that we can understand, three facts that we have knowledge of as a result of Jesus Christ. And the first one is, as a result of walking in the light, we know what we are. We know what we are. You know, in darkness, it's easy to avoid seeing the truth. It's easy to avoid seeing reality, you know. I am thankful that in our house, in our bedroom, we don't have a mirror in our bedroom. So when I get up in the morning and I get dressed, I can look however I want to look, you know, and I look good. And sometimes, you know, I'll go in the bathroom and I'll be getting ready and everything. And I just go, you know, I look really, really good today until I put my glasses on. But in the darkness, we sometimes hide from reality. And as light grows darker, details seem to fade away, but in the light we see more clearly. We see the truth. And in the light, the true light that is Jesus Christ, we see the whole truth. You know, as humanity, when we look upon ourselves, we cannot help but see some unpleasant things. We see our flaws, we see our failures, we see our sin, and I appreciate so much the song that Jeff sang this morning about how God looks at us through the blood of Jesus Christ. And I'm not discounting that. But when we look at humanity, we see that we stand in need. And it's an important reality for us to see. But what is far more important is the realization, the recognition, the acceptance of the truth that we are God's. He is our Creator. He desires to be our Savior. He is worthy to be our Lord. And as we look at this passage, as we contemplate the light of the world, the light that shines, let us remember that in this we can see Christ as our guide that shines through this life and into the next. You know, He is calling forth. He is leading us on. He is drawing us unto Himself. As the light, He is directing us. He is leading us. You know, in the Psalms, we are reminded so many times, all throughout the Psalms, over and over, those Psalms that were written, we see these words in these songs, lead me. Let me share with you several of them. Psalm 5, and you don't have to keep note of all of these, but you're welcome to. Psalm 5:8 says, lead me, O Lord, in your righteousness because of my enemies. Psalm 23:2, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. And the third verse of Psalm 23, he restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Psalm 25, verse 5 says, lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. On you I wait all the day. Psalm 27:11, teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Psalm 31:1. For you are my rock and my fortress. Therefore, for your name's sake, lead me and guide me. Psalm 43:3, oh, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Psalm 61:2, from the end of the earth I will cry to you. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Psalm 139:24, and see if there is any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. And the last one, Psalm 143, verse 10, teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Your spirit is good. Lead me in the land of uprightness. Christ as our light, as our leader. He is our guide in this world. And the great thing, the amazing thing, the awesome thing, the gracious thing, the fantastic thing about him is he doesn't lead us like a lighthouse that's way off in the distance, that's just kind of flashing. He's like those ushers in old-time movie theaters. You know, they don't do it anymore, but I've seen some movies where, you know, they go to the movie, and what would the usher do? The usher would walk up to them, and they'd take a flashlight, and they'd light the way as they walked with you on the journey to your final destination. That is how Christ, as our guide, as our leader, as our light, directs us. Oh yes, sometimes he points off in the distance, but he says, here, let's go together.
Amen.
Today, as we reflect on Jesus as the light of the world, let us be reminded that he is our light, and as such, he seeks to guide us, to lead us. You know, sometimes in this life, it seems like we are surrounded by darkness. But darkness is truly the illusion, because Christ is the light. He can and he will lead us and direct us because he is the light. But this can only happen when we look to him, when we allow him to be our light. You know, there's a lot of us here this morning, and many of us, I'm sure, are facing difficulties or struggles, issues, concerns. And maybe some of us are uncertain. Some of us need direction. We need leadership. Well, Christ is here. Christ is the light. You know, he's not a character in some book. He's not a fantasy. He's not a fairy tale. He's a person. He's alive. He's well. He is real, and he wants to work in your life, in my life, in our life, to accomplish his purposes. So this morning, let us remember what we are. We are the followers of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We are disciples of the Messiah. And let us raise our voices like the psalmists did and say, lead me. Lead me. Second, as we are walking in the light, a result of that, not only do we know what we are, but we know where we are. You know, this world, it is full of so much that is beautiful. In the United States alone, there is so much beauty. Natural wonders, like my wife. No, just kidding. Yes. Natural wonders like the Rocky Mountains, which are beautiful from a distance, but once you get up on top of them, they're terrifying. Like the Grand Canyon, like Niagara Falls, or the good old Great Lakes of Michigan. So many sights, they can take our breath away, but there are other sights. Sights that are equally capable of causing a reaction to those that look upon them. Sights like a starving child, an addicted mother, a son who is selling himself for money. These sights are not sights of beauty, rather they are sights that repulse. And though we sing the song, "This is my Father's world," and we recognize that God truly is the owner of this world, we must realize that we as human beings have taken God's perfect creation and turned it into a world of sin. We abuse it and misuse it. And no, this isn't a big environmentalist around this planet, people freely and openly practice some of the most depraved acts. They do so to satisfy themselves and to satisfy their appetites and their desires, with no thought really of anyone else, let alone God. And if we know that we are the followers of Jesus, we must realize and we must know where we are. Because when we read in Scripture, especially if you look in the New Living Translation, it says it so very nicely. Hebrews 13, verse 14 says, "This world, it is not our permanent home." We must remember that this is not the ultimate goal. This is not as good as it gets. Indeed, this is why Jesus warns us not to have the wrong perspective when he says in Matthew 6, verse 19, don't lay up for yourselves treasure on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. This is not all that there is, folks. Indeed, there is so much more for us. There is more for us to know. And this brings us really to our final point, that as a result of walking in the light, we can know where we're going. As believers in Jesus Christ, as followers of Jesus, as his disciples, we can be assured of our final destination, and we call that what? Heaven. And you know, unfortunately, there's a modern trend nowadays that likes to talk about heaven and say, oh, well, you know, they deny the existence of heaven. But if heaven really exists, well, it certainly can't be a literal place. And these teachings really are absolutely contrary to the Word of God. They're contrary to the words of Jesus. They're contrary to the Bible. But, if, you know, in some places they think, well, don't let that be an issue for you. But in fact, the Bible teaches that heaven is real. It's a real place. It's an actual place. Every bit as real as Place Center, Kansas. Could you imagine? There's probably some crazy people. In fact, I used to know some people that if you said, hey, there's a place called Place Center, Kansas, I'd say, oh, you're making it up. When we lived back in Michigan, I heard about this place called Place Center, and I was like, nah. Except I went and talked to a woman with the last, her name was Rachel Martin. And she was related to some of the Martins in town. And she goes, I grew up in Clay Center, Kansas. And I was like, you are a nut, lady. No. Clay Center is real. And heaven is every bit as real as Clay Center. And as much as I like Clay Center, heaven is so much better than Clay Center could ever hope to be. Don't tell the mayor I said that. Heaven is an actual place. That's why we read passages like John chapter 14 that says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in me, believe also in God. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. He says, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. In those three verses, Jesus references and refers to heaven as a place. It's not a state of mind. It's not an ideology. It's not a goal that is not a literal location. This is why the Bible, when it talks about heaven, it talks about heaven as a dwelling place. Scripture describes heaven as the location where the throne of God sits. So for those people that say, well, there's no real heaven, well, I guess they're saying that there's no throne of God. And those are probably the same people who say that, well, there's no God anyways. But Scripture says God is there, His throne is there, Jesus Christ is there, angels are there. And as Philippians 3, verse 20 reminds us, our citizenship is there. Another wonderful verse that speaks of the truth of heaven, of paradise, is Luke chapter 23, verse 43, where Jesus tells the thief on the cross, today you'll be with me in paradise. Mm-hmm. Now, if that wasn't a literal place, how cruel Jesus was to that man. But we know it is true. We know it is true, and it is far, far better than we could ever imagine. Christ is the light of the world. He is shining His light, allowing us to know the truth, to realize the facts of what we are, and where we're going. And it's that reality of what we are, and where we're going that ought to spur us into action, that ought to encourage us to reach out to one another. that ought to challenge us to share those truths with the people in our community. Because there are people that don't know what they are, or where they are, or where they could be going. As believers, we are following Jesus Christ. He is leading us through this life, this world, into the next. As believers, we have hope. We have a promise of a new home, a permanent home, a paradise in the very presence of our Creator, our Sustainer, our Light, our God. We must not forget these truths. And let's be honest, it is easy to get bogged down, isn't it? It's easy to get distracted by the garbage that sometimes surrounds us, the troubles and the problems and the disappointments. And I hate to be disappointed. I don't really know anybody that likes to be disappointed. But the pain and the frustration, the darkness. But that is why we must look for the light. Look for that light of Jesus that shines even in the darkest hours. It is there. He is there with His outstretched hands. He is calling to us to lead us through. So today we have a choice. We can look to the world with its darkness and we can pursue its agenda, or we can look to the Lord, to the light. The reality, the truth, the fact. We can look to that because you know what? We can't do both. Scripture says we can't serve two masters. We can't serve the Lord and ourselves. We can't serve the world and the Lord. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. He says that we won't walk in darkness. This means that we'll know the truth, that we'll see the truth. But the choice is, will we walk according to the truth? Or are we willing to go and live in the lie? Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you so much for your word. We thank you for its power. We thank you that it is truth. That Jesus speaks the truth. And as that passage that Jerry read for us this morning reminds us, Father, we pray that you would speak to our hearts this morning. That perhaps there are some here this morning that do not yet know you. They've not yet accepted your Son Jesus as their Savior. We pray that you would speak to their heart this day, that they would make that choice. We are reminded, as Scripture teaches, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We are reminded that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so we pray that each one that is here this morning, each one that hears or sees this message, Lord, that they would take the opportunity to look at their lives, consider it, and make sure that they've made that choice to place their faith and trust in Jesus Christ as their Lord, as their Savior. And we pray, too, that as believers in Jesus Christ, that we would look to Jesus, that we would see Him as the light, the source of truth, that we would not be deceived or distracted by the lies of this world, but rather we would keep our eyes firmly fixed on our Savior. That whatever we're facing, in good times or bad, that we continue to look to Him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Will you stand as we have our hymn of response? Turn your eyes upon Jesus. lunch this afternoon. If you're not able to, we hope that you have we hope that the rest of the day is a blessing for you. And of course, we invite you to come back this evening at 5 p.m. for our Sunday evening Bible study. But let's be dismissed with prayer. Father God, we thank you so very much for the opportunity to assemble this morning. We thank you for each one that is here. And pray, Lord, that you would challenge us, that as we go through life, that we would stay focused and we would recognize the blessing that we have to have Jesus in our life. Jesus as the light of the world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.